I'm Kelsey Zeiser. I'm a senior editor at Light Reading, and we're here at Mobile World Congress in Las Vegas. I'm joined by the wonderful Mari Silbey with US Ignite.
Nice to be here. Good to see you, Kelsey.
You too, Mari. So what have you been up to this week? I heard you heard some interesting things on Open RAN.
I mean, Open RAN is all the buzzword, right? I mean, you cannot literally go into a session without hearing people talk about Open RAN. And in some ways, it's kind of become the new 5G. It just means nothing anymore, which is okay. Everybody's behind it, so of course it's only going to mean so much. But it really does mean different things to different people. And what we're hearing is that on the one hand, for commercial deployments, people really want to be able to do testing for interoperability, particularly in the front haul interface, to be able to make sure that they can, again, interoperate between different radio vendors, different CU and DU vendors. Mm-hmm. But that's really only a piece of the puzzle, because the other big promise of Open RAN is that it will accelerate the innovation ecosystem and allow more smaller players, not just a few new radio vendors, but more players across the board to come in and get behind the wheel and actually tinker with some of these things that have traditionally been, you know, have been closed and proprietary. So there's a lot of excitement. Also, people are seeing a lot of dollar signs right now because there's a lot of money about to come from the federal government.
Yeah. What are some of the challenges with Open RAN in terms of, you know, is it really a turnkey solution? It seems like it's not as easy to deploy as maybe some telcos would have hoped.
So there's growing pains for sure. The biggest Open RAN proponents will tell you that it's out there, it's being deployed across the world, and that's true, but usually that means it's being deployed with groups of vendors that work together, or, you know, there's a piece of the O-RAN puzzle that's being deployed, but not all of it. So there is definitely still work to do, but I have not seen this much excitement about a technology from all sides, pretty much. I mean, the government wants this, the industry wants this, would be a pretty hard snowball to stop rolling downhill at this point.
Okay, yeah.
In the Las Vegas desert in particular,
right,
by the way.
I like
snowball analogies work so well here.
Very nice, yeah. Well, it did rain yesterday morning,
it
which
did.
Was weird.
I got soaked. It was terrible.
No.
It was terrible.
So you've also been following the spectrum updates. What's going on there? It sounds like everybody wants a piece of that as well.
There's going to be a knife fight. Oh. No, I mean, there always is. There always is, right? Spectrum's incredibly valuable. Is an incredibly important asset and commodity and makes a lot of people a lot of money. But what was really interesting to me was hearing some of the commercial providers yesterday really making the case that they need more licensed spectrum and that we have essentially given away too much spectrum to the unlicensed space. Mm. And even calling for, you know, especially in the mid-band, not doing sharing between licensed and unlicensed. We don't need any more of that, essentially. I even heard somebody say, hey, even in the CBRS band, which is where we're doing sharing today, that it's time to, you know, let the actual deployers, the network operators, ramp up the power a little bit on their commercial licensed parts of the frequency mm-hmm. band, which, you know, would have implications on performance for the unlicensed users, of course.
Yeah.
So it's really interesting. And then, you know, of course, there's more spectrum bands that people are now eyeing. What comes next? How will it be? What licensing scheme or non-licensing scheme will the FCC decide to use? How will government, federal users play nice or not play nice with the commercial industry? It's gonna be interesting.
Yeah, so any thoughts on why they don't wanna share anymore? What's going on? They don't wanna play in the sandbox
one,
together?
Sharing is difficult. but two, everybody just wants, like, give me this turf, give me this really easy space that I don't have to worry about other people crowding out what it is I wanna do, mm-hmm. and let me just run with it. I mean, there's a lot, it's a finite resource, so it's incredibly precious. So the more anybody can get of it, it's, you know, give me all the spectrum.
Yeah.
just give it to me.
And so they want more of the licensed spectrum than unlicensed.
The
right
industry
now?
Does, for okay. sure. For
yeah.
sure.
What's the reasoning behind that?
Again, this isn't anything new, mm-hmm. But the idea is that the mid-band spectrum is so precious, it shouldn't be wasted mm-hmm. on unlicensed,
okay.
Which, there's a point to be made. On the other hand, look at all of the innovation that we've had in Wi-Fi. So it's just everybody's going to have an interest in an agenda.
Yeah.
So there's going to be a lot of fighting.
Yeah. So speaking of fighting, we're talking online about the industry fracturing a little bit. Tell us more about what's going on there.
Yeah. So this is my own sort of view of the world at this point. We are and this happens anytime there's disruption in innovation industry, but we're seeing more stakeholders, so more people who want to be a part of the connectivity game, whether that's private companies, whether that's municipalities or community groups, different verticals. Like, all of a sudden, there are all these other pieces besides what we used to think of as kind of the big buckets, the three or four carriers, national carriers, and the government spectrum holders. That really, there's a lot more people who care about this now than ever before. The technology is also fracturing, if you think about it. Again, we're talking about opening up these networks, disaggregating the pieces, trying to figure out how to do more with these disaggregated pieces. And then from the use case perspective, people want to do different things with connectivity. I mean, it used to be you picked up a telephone and, you know, all you wanted to do was place a call. Well, now people want to fly drones that are connected and stream, you know, footage back over a 5G connection, which I mentioned, by the way, because we did that recently at a testbed of ours in the Platforms for Advanced Wireless Research program down in the AirPod testbed in North Carolina. And that was actually in partnership with Ericsson, who provided the 5G connection there. So
very cool.
Very excited to
demonstrate. Yeah, a little shout out to my home state too.
That's right, right, yeah. Right down the road from you.
North Carolina, it's better than South Carolina. Just putting it out there.
What's the bar here, Kelsey? What's the bar?
Okay. That's fair, Mari.
Anything else that you know, are excited about this week or that?
I am excited about leaving Las Vegas. To me personally, this is not my favorite place to be. This is a shout out to CTIA and GSMA. Let's go back to LA. Whatever, a conference is a conference.
Yeah.
At the end of the day, I'm always ready to go home.
Yeah, for sure. Well, thanks for taking the opportunity to talk with me before you leave Las Vegas.
Always a pleasure, Kelsey.
Yeah.